I think all of us really want a bad guy right now. If we, for example, were to be able to blow him up right now, just he's gone, he's just a beard, that's all that's left. What, you know, would we after that, it's a great image right now for a lot of us, but is that solving a problem, really? Is that doing anything other than martyring him and creating maybe, you know, 5,000 other people that are willing to give their lives to do something horrible to us?
Given the choice of killing him or not killing him, I'd kill him.
Yeah. It's a weird new game show.
Right.
That's what it's become. It's like, you can kill Osama bin Laden or choose what's behind this curtain.
The reason I mentioned Gaddafi is because we tend as a country to go through that. We feel like we need to have a villain. It was Gaddafi. It was a whole succession of people, Saddam. There are, the problem is much more complicated than that. And yes, will 10 Osama bin Ladens rise out of the ashes? Perhaps, maybe. Which is why we need to figure out what the best way to deal with this is. I think obviously there is going to be military action at some point. It needs to be against targets that are going to make a difference. And it needs to succeed. And I think if we do something half-assed, can I say that?
No, you're fired. Okay. You're on a competing network. I can't touch you.
That it will...
Please fire him, Hank.
It will add to everybody's frustration.
Right.
And I think we need to act carefully. I think that one of the things that you brought up, the Taliban, I think that I spent last year a period of time in Pakistan doing a story on essentially this subject. We think we have problems in this country. Pakistan has so many problems you would not even be able to comprehend it. They've got their elected president of the country is in jail. The country is being run by a general. You have 70 million people that don't even have clean water every day.
Mm-hmm.
You have 400,000 militant armed Islamic radicals inside the country that are essentially militias. And you're talking about a country that has nuclear capabilities,
yeah,
that has the bomb. So if we decide that we're going to do something in that part of the world and we're going to utilize Pakistan, we have to carefully weigh all the things that could go wrong by doing that.
We could ostensibly get Pakistan's okay to have troops there, but incite a large part of the country to hate us even more and
destabilize the government even further, where
right,
you could have 400,000 mujahideen who essentially came there from all over the world because of the jihad in Afghanistan against the Russians. You could have that turned against the government.
Mm-hmm.
You could have General Musharraf's government fall, and you could end up with exactly the people you don't want running that country with access to nuclear weapons. I think that is something that's on everybody's mind. So if you're going to do something, you have to think it through and not make things any worse than they are.
The country has to be patient, is what
the country
saying.
Has to be patient. We have to figure out a way to do it. We need to get as many countries behind us as we possibly can. I think the Russians are important.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have borders in that part of the world. I think we need to work with the Iranians. We have to try and build a consensus. And
long haul. This is going to take a lot of money,
in for the
a lot
long
of time.
Haul. And I think it's a wonderful effort. I mean, I think that if you decide and you are able to get people behind you to wipe this out once and for all, or to cripple it to the point where it becomes not such a serious threat.
Right.
That it will be a worthwhile endeavor, and that we ought, you know, it's worth fighting.
It's going to be, I think, this country's primary focus.
Right.
I have to believe after last Tuesday, this is now our we have our marching orders. Mm-hmm. I think, if nothing else, let's take a quick break. We'll have more with Steve Croft when we come back. Stick around.
Italy has been through it with the Red Brigades.
Right.
Everybody has been through it except us, and you can deal with it. Life will go on. You will have to make certain adjustments, but life goes on. I want to tell this story that when I moved to London for CBS back in 1984, One of the first stories I did, I went up to Nottingham and covered Torval and Dean, the ice dancers, after the Olympics.
You used to cover Torval and Dean?
Yeah. It's my one experience in the ice.
Let's not go there. Look at you. Okay. Ah, Torval and Dean.
So anyway,
ice kids.
I'm there, and as I frequently do when I travel all over the world, I left something behind. I left a pair of loafers. So I called up the hotel and I said, can you send them down? And they wrapped the shoe, I sent them in a shoebox and wrapped it up with brown paper, and they put like this big red sticker on it, Red Ball Express, which was the train. They called me, and I went over to St. Pancras Station one Saturday morning and picked it up and stopped on Bond Street to do some shopping, and I went to have some breakfast, and when I realized that I lost my shoes again. Where did I leave them?
Were you barefoot at the time?
No, I had on another pair. I had a pair of lace-ups.
Okay.
So,
actually,
I had on ice skates. I went back and I started retracing my steps, and I get down to where they have this Irish shop, and right off Berkeley Square, and I see hundreds and hundreds of people, and they've got the street blocked off and everything. So I'm walking back down, what's going on? I'm not going to be able to get through to get my shoes. So I asked what happened. I said, oh, you know, there's a suspicious package in there. They've got the bomb squad.
Oh, God.
So I tapped one of the guys on the shoulder, and I says, I think might be my package, you know. And he says, okay, well, let's
see.
See,
I'd have kept walking. I'd have been like, oh, it looks dangerous. Oh, see you later. Good job, fellas.
I wanted the loafers.
Yeah. Those were beautiful.
So I went back in, and I walked literally, and he had these guys with all this lead stuff and shields and whatnot,
right.
And they're all looking at this package, and I just reached down and picked it up. And I said, I'm sorry, these are shoes. I'll be on my way. And, you know, it's one of the things that London, and from living through it, they're aware of things like that.
Well, it's funny because
they'll point out strange pieces of luggage. They'll point out unattended bags. They'll say, you know, they'll call somebody. They'll draw attention to it. And I think that's what I'm talking about.
Actually,
I think that will change.
I do find that a little comforting that, you know, some people might say, well, that's depressing that we have to live that way. It's about being more aware. It's about changing our life somewhat. But every other country has done it, has lived through this, and, you know, we can too. I find that actually to be a little bit encouraging, don't you?
Let me give you two airline security stories to give you an example of how I think things can be fixed relatively easily. One, the Department of Transportation Inspector General's office probed the system 2 or 3 years ago, and they were concerned mostly with secure areas at the airport.
Right.
So once you get into those secure airports, you can go pretty much anywhere. You can go down on the ramps, you can go in the cargo holds, you can do anything. And they got through 63% of the time by following people in, by watching people do the number thing and then go and copying it.
Right.
They went in and they had blatantly fraudulent identifications. You know, they had men with women IDs and things like that. And nobody stopped them except for one Delta person. Some of it is just an awareness of the things around you.
Right.
There was one study that was done where they were able to get machine guns through the metal detectors, knives and guns through the metal detectors.
That just blows my mind when I have to literally, you know, take my keys out and strip,
you know, how
half
they did
the
it?
Time. And other people, how do they do it? How do you get a machine gun or an Uzi through?
They got it through very simply. They went in with big belt buckles.
Shaped like a machine gun?
No.
It sounds like I'm making a joke, but I just don't understand how that's a belt buckle, you know?
They'd take a pistol or a knife, and they would put it behind the belt buckle inside the shirt. You would go through the metal detector, it would go off. You would come back through the metal detector, it would go off. And they would take the handheld thing, and they would go over the metal and say,
and they would hit the buckle and say,
it's
you
the
can
belt
go through.
Buckle. Go ahead.
But
it's a pretty simple thing to check.
Right. The good thing now is, if we can take any solace, is that we can change.
Yes.
We can get a lot better at this.
Yes.
And we can make it a much safer country.
The one thing I looked at, you know, coming in, going across the Triborough Bridge on Saturday, and looking at the new skyline of New York, and I don't mean to trivialize what happened, because it was a terrible, horrible tragedy.
Right.
And we talk about the country being a war, and we talk about being attacked. It was, when all said and done, one block of this great, big, huge country. and it was a terrible loss. But we're not all under siege, and it is a big, strong country.
Yeah. It's what I was trying to...
The people who did it are doing this because they're weak.
Yeah.
We can't become afraid. We got to realize that we can do this. Other countries have done it. Other countries have succeeded against it. And we just have to do what needs to be done and be prepared to make some sacrifices.
I can't thank you enough for coming by. This helped. I think it just helped all of us. And
you're doing a good job.
It was really nice of you to do it. Stay right here. Don't go yet. Stay.
Okay.
You're not going anywhere.
We're taking a break. When we come back, Sarah Vowell is going to be here from NPR.